pleased to introduce Mr. and Mrs. Patterson.
I think Henry verbalized that he and I have known each other since I was 17, and I actually changed my name lots of years ago, and he didn't even know Gregg and I had been married 26 years, so we haven't seen each other in a while.
In a couple of years.
A couple, like 27 or something.
We're here today to share with you the lessons learned on the Camino. I'd like to give you just a quick background on what is the Camino, because I sure didn't know when I went. But the Camino, legend has it that St. James was one of the apostles. And after the crucifixion, he went to Iberia, which is Spain, and preached, you know, the teachings of Jesus. He went back to Israel, and King Herod beheaded him. And the legend further is they sent his remains to Santiago. So for 1,500 years, pilgrims have been coming from all over Europe on the way to Santiago for repentance for their sins. The earliest recorded pilgrims were in the 11th century.
They still say his remains are there, so they're in this big cathedral in Santiago.
So we'd like to share with you life lessons learned on the Camino, the mental and physical challenges for us finding your life.
We do this handoff thing, so and it's a little different every time. A long time ago, I guess 2002, I read Shirley MacLaine. I used to be, and probably still am a little bit, fairly airy-fairy kind of person, and read all kinds of stuff, and have walked on fire, and done sweat lodges, all kinds of things. So Shirley MacLaine definitely called to me in 2002. And she talked about having done the Camino, and I'm half Spanish, half Puerto Rican, don't speak a word of it, really. And knew at some point that I needed to walk that 500 miles. So I've been telling him for quite a few years that plan on that this is going to happen at some point in time.
And I kept thinking, yeah, have you been in a long-term relationship when someone says something to you completely ridiculous, rather than saying something that's going to make them blow up, I thought, Gregg, just shut up. It'll go away.
Fat chance, exactly. So the year before, in 2013, it was Gregg's 60th birthday, and that wasn't on his bucket list. Doing walking the Camino wasn't on his bucket list, so we did some other things. And then last year was my 60th birthday, so it was like, I'm going. I'm going with or without you. And he still didn't really believe it.
And I'm a type A, stand up, watch TV, in the corporate world, CFO, black and white, nuts and bolts. And you know, my wife's always talking about the power of intention. And you know, I just didn't really buy into it. And I'm thinking, how am I going to go on this trip? We're going to be gone almost 2 months. How am I going to be away from my business? And I was talking with a client, and she said, you're going on the Camino. And I said, well, how am I going to do that? She said, yeah, I've got this huge project I'm going to give you to do in January and February and March. And we're going to spread out the payments over the whole time you're gone, so you have a check coming in. Then on top of that, I'm in Rotary, and a guy was, a friend called me and said, I was getting my hair cut, and a lady cutting my hair said her parents were moving from down near Tampa to Tallahassee, and they were building a house, but their house had sold, and their house wasn't complete yet. And they're saying, looking for a house to live in June and July,
For 50 days, and we were going to be gone for 60.
And it turned out they paid our mortgage, and you think at first people are going to live in our house, but when we came back, I think they took better care of it than we did.
So not only did they live in our house, not only did we not have to pay somebody to house it, they paid our mortgage, which was awesome. So money and mortgage paid, we were good.
So now she's got the power of intention.
I would never say that. Again, back up just a tiny bit, I was going for spiritual reasons. I have always wanted to be a saint. Well, I have to tell you, it didn't work. I did not come back a saint. And he just went to be for the, actually he went to, because I was going. And
That one for the athletic challenge. Yeah, I thought,
once he realized he had to go.
Be a good workout, at least.
Right.
Yeah. At the least, it'll be a good workout.
That's right.
500 miles would be a good workout.
Right.
But it's start St. Jean de Port, France. The first day is... go ahead.
A lot of people go all the way over that, the first day. Not me. I mean, I was lucky to make it to that dot on day one.
Oh, so you're going up that?
You're going up, it starts in St. Jean at 200 feet, and you go up to 1,400 feet.
And you go
it's
up
a
to
long
four,
way.
4,600.
4,600 feet, sorry. 5 miles straight up. And I really was, I had my walker.
Did you have walking sticks? Did you use
walking
sticks?
I did have walking sticks, but you know what? They don't help you breathe. I just don't know why. They weren't helping me breathe.
Walking.
Go ahead. I know one thing I wanted to say is, and I know he had done it. Gregg was doing stadiums. He was walking. He was doing all this amazing stuff to train.
FSU Campbell Stadium, doing all the stadiums.
And I only read one thing about the Camino, and it was this 50-year-old man who was 50 pounds overweight who did nothing, and he made it, so that was my training thing. Do nothing, be 50 pounds overweight, and be a 60-year-old woman. So.
And see the look on her face?
I was happy.
First day, but you're up there, you're walking with, you know, through cows, and, but it's, I mean, like I said on the video, a couple days into it, I walk on out here, what was I thinking?
Might have been that day.
And
there
it was. This was her journey. I talk about training, and there was no negotiation. This was her trip. This is how she's doing it. So there we went. Going down to day two. Going down is tougher than going up. We learned that lesson.
Yeah. This one was actually, I thought it was fairly easy. It's so funny how we all look at life differently and do life differently. I just knew we were going to make it, and Gregg just knew we weren't. And so we were heading up to the top of that. There were two ways you could go. You could go down the road, which was the simpler but longer route. And trust and believe, day one, I was not interested in longer. Or you could go down the steeper route. And all the way from where we started to this point, he kept saying, oh, well, we'll break our leg. People are breaking their legs. They're this, they're
right,
that.
Somebody warned
so
you. Don't go down
that way. You're gonna die if you go down that way. And we get there, and it was really one of the most beautiful routes. It really was lovely, and it wasn't near as hard, but it wasn't raining, and it wasn't snowing. And so we really had a wonderful walk down. But, of course, our minds tell us a whole lot different than reality, don't they?
And there's challenges on the walk. You know, there's steep grades. You learned an hour of 12%.
I did learn what 12% means. I don't know what it means in math, but I know what it means going uphill. It's steep.
And a lot of the paths, so, I mean, were just rocks, and more rocks. So you had to have a walking stick?
Yeah, by the end, every time he'd see a rock, here's some more of your damn rocks.
You
they were more
hours
of rocks
on
by
these
the
rocks.
End.
You figure if there's a thousand people, we should pick up some of these rocks.
It's a 1,000-year-old trail?
1,500-year-old
trail.
Yeah.
Then when you're walking, you're out in the weather, but it turns out that we lucked out.
You want to tell them about some of the things that you never worried about, and they never came to pass?
Yeah, I spent many times pacing the floor worrying about many things that never came to pass. And with the walking, I had bought non-weatherproof shoes because they breathe. But then I started worrying walking in the rain, I'm going to get blisters. So I kept worrying about it. I even got to the point where I went into this Fabulous Hotel and got their garbage bag and put it inside my shoes, and I was slipping around, and that didn't work, but we ended up walking in the rain.
He worried, honestly, every day. Have you ever had somebody that said something over and over and over again, and you just want to go, please, I can't hear it one more time? And it was funny because we had rain. This was, I think we had rain 15 minutes, and you see how well we're dressed. And then another time we had rain for about 30 minutes. And then we had rain one day, and we weren't going to go. We were going to take a rest that day. And about 9 o'clock, we just said, what the heck? Let's go for a walk. So off we went and had the
Turned
best
out,
time.
I felt like I was a 7-year-old again. You're out in the rain. It was just really cool.
And so now in Tallahassee, we've had pictures taken of us out walking in the rain with our
kids. And some nights it's raining, and we'll look at each other. You ready to go for a walk?
What months were you there?
June
and July. We picked, it couldn't have been more beautiful weather. I mean, 3 hours of rain one day and 30 minutes another day and 5 minutes another. We were blessed. And we did run into some mud, so there must have been some rain somewhere, but we were blessed.
There's challenges of blisters.
Sexy toes, huh?
What I would do is every morning I'd get up and I'd use this runner's glide and I'd put it on my feet. It's like this stuff right here. And I would use a little duct tape. Except that was some pretty duct tape she had.
I bought the prettiest stuff.
Will you tape up your blisters?
Before they got blisters.
Well, I'd start feeling a hot spot. I'd put that on there and I never got a blister.
I'm a nurse, I should know better, but I didn't, obviously. I put that on a blister, and I wrapped it over the top of my toe, and left it there for 2 days. And within those 2 days, I managed to damage the quick of my toe and could not put my boots on. And we were out in the middle of
nowhere.
I mean,
the little town we're in, the grocery store was in someone's living room.
Like this big of the living room. That was the grocery store. And we had a 19-kilometer walk with nothing. I mean, nothing. And the only thing I had were these sweet little sandals. And he was freaking out. We need to take a bus. We need to take a bus to the next town. We're never going to make it. Something's going to happen. Maybe we just need to take a bus to Santiago. And we went downstairs to have breakfast, and here are these young kids, and they're in their Tevas. They were in their sandals. And so he finally decided that he could at least breathe long enough for us to walk. And I ended up walking in those sandals for 2 days. I couldn't put my boots on. Got to a big town and bought some more sandals that were awesome. And I walked the rest of the trail in sandals and wool socks. It was great.
But there's a lot of challenges. And this is why after a long walk, they had stairs at the end.
A long walk. Like, you're so tired, you can't get into the town.
You've got
to you can't get to your bed
until you climb those stairs.
And you may have walked 16 miles. And now you got to climb those stairs. Was it nice?
Longest walking day?
20 miles. And, you know, it doesn't sound so bad. Well, maybe. It doesn't sound so bad, 20 miles, but you have to remember you're walking 15 miles every day. 15, 16, 20 every day.
To get it done in 38 days.
Right? Yeah. And we rested, too.
Another lesson that Morgan started on here, and I found we can even do this since we're back. I would encourage you to do it. We would start, each one of us individually would walk in honor of someone. I would walk in honor of a grandparent or someone that had passed. I would think about what was it like when they were born, where they lived, you know, what was it like when they were, you know, college or young adults. And it really brings you connected with them. It really does. And then we'd work into our kids and grandkids. And
it's so interesting how we all walk this path differently. You know, I mean, he's thinking all these things. And for me, I just carried them with me. You know, I didn't have any. I just carried them with me, and I knew they were with me. And I would pick up a rock. I came home with too many dang rocks. My backpack weighed more when I left than it did when I got there. But I would pick up a rock, and I would hold it in my hand, and I would carry it with me all day. And I would, so often I would think of that rock and I would think of them and I would send them love, and I know that they felt that. I'm not somebody who has to think things out. I'm more a feely kind of person. But so we can all do this in whatever way we choose, really.
The other lesson too, and it's really important in what's going on in our world today, is you meet people on this trail from all over the world, South Korea, Romania, Ethiopia, and the more we talk with each other, you find out we're more alike than we are different.
Sure.
And that's a lesson that we could sure use that's spreading in our society today.
So there were a lot of folks on the trail. Huh?
There was. You know, I don't know what it is, for the first three quarters of the trail, there would be days we wouldn't see anybody. I mean, hours where you wouldn't see anybody. The other really nice thing for me, some people will have a hard time realizing this, I'm really an introvert. I can just as soon stay in my own little world and not talk to anybody. It's possible, even though you're around however many people, to do things however you want. For Gregg, it was awesome because he got to chat. You know, he would meet people all over the world. And so it was really good. You can do it however you want.
Yeah, I really enjoyed it. One night I went into the bar, and a bar there is much different than a bar here. Bar is where everyone comes in and plays dominoes and Yeah, there's food, but there is alcohol.
Kids running all over the place.
And I sat there one night and had an hour-long conversation with a gentleman. He spoke no English, and I'm un poco español, very little. And we had a great conversation. Here we are.
I think he traded me for a camel or something.
But here we are in a hospital. The fellow up here, he had lost his relationship and his business and from Australia. His mother put him on a plane in Sydney.
Yeah, his mother actually spent the night with him in a hotel because she knew he would bolt. So she spent the night with him in a hotel. She knew he was in trouble, and she put him on the plane so that he would walk the trail to Santiago and find him his life.
And the PBs are Welsh folks, very nationalistic, spoke, is it Gaelic they speak, or Welsh?
Welsh.
Uh-huh. This is Charlie, originally from Scotland, a retired merchant marine and from Sydney.
The other thing about it is you might meet somebody this week and you don't see them again for 3 weeks. And then you go, you figure they've gone, you know, they've disappeared someplace. And then you show up and there they are again. It's just like, it's so cool to see people that you've spent all day walking with and you don't see them for 2 weeks.
And they're a mile or two up the road or behind you.
Yeah, somewhere. And we're staying different. There's lots of different albergues to stay in. So, yeah.
This is Jen Howe from South Korea. Our first selfie, we didn't do a very good job.
She didn't speak any English?
No. These are at a hostel afterwards. We're playing, drinking a little bit of wine. Had people from France, the U.S., England, ourselves.
Canada. This was so neat because we had some Canadians that spoke French and some French who didn't speak any English. The Canadians spoke English and French, so they were the translators. We sang American music, American 80s music. And we even shipped somebody in from another that was down at a bar that was walking also to come and play the guitar so that we could all sing together and drink and have a grand time.
It's really odd. I walked into this place, a restaurant out in the middle of nowhere. No one spoke any English. And I walk in and on the radio they're playing Wichita Lineman.
They have English music on the radio.
Yeah.
The people, again, these are people from Ireland and the U.S. There's one lesson I learned on the Camino on judgment. This guy right here, I saw him in a hospital, and you see someone, you kind of feel like you can pick up on him, and this guy's scruffy, and go, this guy's up no good, and I know it. And he's not getting near my backpack, and I'm keeping my eye on this guy.
And he warned me about him.
Next day, this is what happens to me, we're walking along, this guy and his friend catch up with us and decide to start walking with us. I'm going, great, these people are going to start walking with us. But the more we walked with them, they seemed to be, they were teaching English, they're from Northern Ireland, teaching English in Madrid. I had the Irish accent, I thought this would be interesting, learning about Ireland. And we got to know them, and kept crossing paths. And one night we're having dinner with him, and I found out this guy I didn't trust was going back to get his PhD in conflict resolution.
So please be worried.
Great. We still exchange emails with just a kind, gentle soul from the farm.
The thing I'm just going to toss in, and the thing about the judgment thing is it's, don't we all do that? We do that all the time. We look at somebody, and we've already got it figured out in our head, who they are, what we can expect from them, what we think about them, and this isn't a sales pitch, but my book is about that. It's about non-judgment. It's about accepting people, and it wrote itself mostly before we left, and then when we came back, I realized that it had three more things that needed to go in. It needed to be Gregg, and it's just little vignettes about people. You know, you see this person, how I judge them or how I see them. And so the people we love, the people that live in our lives, we judge them. I mean, I think I do. I mean, I put more judgments on him probably than I put on anybody in the world. And so they come, the people we love are there so that we can practice that, so we can let go of those things. So it was interesting. And I ended up putting myself in there. I don't know if you guys do. I know I judge myself. So ends up being the last one. So it was interesting how I didn't come back a saint, but I did finish my book, so that was awesome.
This is someone from the Netherlands, someone from Ireland. This is a banker and his family from Texas. They had sold the house and walking with her oldest son, and yeah.
Didn't even know where they were going to live. Put everything in a storage shed, and off they went.
Eating in the hostels, I mean, sometimes the food was very good, and sometimes it wasn't. This night it was very good, but you break bread from those people from Japan and all over.
Those kids were bikers. They came in, and they were biking it. It was pretty fun.
Can you bicycle the trail, like on a mountain bike?
You can.
But you'd use a road bike, because it runs parallel to it quite a bit.
But well, there is paved road parallel
to
the
hike. It wasn't actually a road bike, because they were on the rough trail
something.
They were riding probably hybrids.
Yes.
Well, yeah.
Some of them would come down from the Netherlands and were coming all the way to Santiago. This is a doctor from the Basque region that we met.
He brought a bunch of kids. This was so cool. They had a whole bunch of seniors, they weren't even seniors. They were just high schoolers, and they had to give up every day something that they were carrying. And the first day they had to give up their cell phones. And they could use their cell phones for an hour to talk to their family at night. But they had to give up their cell phones. And the kids were just, it was so fun. They were so full of life. Even some days when we were kind of doing this, and they were, woo, 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 you know, they're yelling.
That little kid in the red is Nadal from Nepal.
So you did have reception on cell phones the whole trail pretty much.
No.
If you needed it, no?
No.
If you got a Spanish cell phone,
we didn't get a Spanish one. We had our own. We would find Wi-Fi, sit on little corners,
right. Okay.
Find Wi-Fi when we would get in to places.
We also met people from all over. This is when we got into Santiago, but this is a CIA tribe, Canada, Ireland, and America. In fact, when we came into Santiago, we were joking the CIA has come to liberate Santiago. And we had crossed these paths with them on occasion. One night we were coming down from where the Iron Cross is, and it was 5 hours of coming down these rocks. It was really tough.
It was tough.
And it was sad.
Rick fell one time.
Almost off the side once.
Off the side once. It was rough.
And it was starting to rain. It was dark. It was Saturday night. We're going to the rural village. And it turned out that the main hostel or Alberge was being fumigated, and there were two weddings that night, and there was a fiesta in the next town, and it was starting to rain, there was no place to stay.
And I was crying. I was tired, I needed a place to put my head.
And we found a few other people that were doing the same, and we kept looking, and finally we'd go into these bars, and again, the bar is quite different. Found one where the lady knows no English, but very, very limited Spanish. Found out she had a place in an attic, and it was a very nice attic, but she only had four beds, and we had five of us, right? And we just made the decision we weren't going to leave anyone out. Finally, we talked her into dragging a mattress in, and kind of when I went to bed that night, I felt, this is my tribe. And so we kind of kept crossing paths, and we called ourselves the CIA tribe.
I'm
going to
toss in one thing here, and I don't even see her. Is there another one of those pictures?
It was actually a bigger tribe than that, huh?
There's a couple missing. This young lady right here was from Ireland.
She's
and
there.
I see her mom and her.
Oh, she took this picture.
That's right. That's because you're in it.
That's right.
She was from Ireland. She actually is a music director. She runs musicians. And so we met her the very first day. And she walked during the daytime and then was on her computer in the evening. She had three bands that she was working in the world while she was walking. And actually, the people that worked for her didn't know she wasn't, like, right there in Ireland. They thought she was, and she was in Santiago. She was in Spain. But the first day we met her, she really gave me a gift because, you know, I don't care how strong you are, 15 pounds on your backpack sometimes can be really heavy. And so she gave me the gift. She said, you know what? There was this guy that walked a really long way carrying a really, really heavy load for me 1,500 years ago, and I don't have to do that. So they make it possible that you can actually ship your backpack ahead. So there were days when I just said, you know what? Just getting me over these mountains is enough. I do not have to carry extra weight. And it was just such a gift. It was such a gift.
So there was like a service that kind of provided support.
There was a service right there in each albergue. You put where you were going on your thing. You left €6 for them to pay for it, and then they would get it to where you were going. My problem is I have a CPAP. I sleep with CPAP. I had to have it, so I had to get where my bag was every night. So it was, you know, it's a double-edged sword. It's nice if you don't have to carry it, but now I can't stop here when I'm tired. I have to go there. So
again, it's a spiritual pilgrimage. This is that picture that, yeah, I went by it and scratching and screaming and did everything to avoid going there, and I wasn't going to have the spiritual, but I had that. And then I didn't think I was going to, you know, I kind of kept it to myself, and at our church we had a bonfire, and one of the guys there said, we ought to finish a blog, because I wrote blogs about the press follows. And I thought about it for a while, and said, well, I'll put it in there to put it at the back of the paper, because, you know, I'm not ready to come out with my spiritual stuff. I go out to get the paper, and it's the whole front page. I'm going, jeez, I can't believe they did this. And then the FSU Film School came, said, we want to do a documentary. I finally, I get it. Said, okay, I get it. I get the spiritual thing. I'm going to get it. This is the Iron Cross, and I think we're about to run that. People carry a stone up here for someone to remember. Look at all the stones.
It's the highest point.
Of the whole hike, the whole trail.
And then here is they have the Pilgrim's Mass at the end, which is very emotional and very...
It is emotional. I started crying before
that's the
we
last
got in there. Yeah. Yeah, and it's funny because you meet people, and again, here's that judgment thing. We met this young man from California who was going to be a priest, and he was walking, and I said, are you walking to find out whether or not you really want to join the priesthood? He said, no, I'm just walking because I think it'll be fun. And then we met this other young man from Ireland who...
Somebody from Dublin.
Dublin. And I was struggling one day, and he goes skipping by singing, and, you know, it's just like, I couldn't believe somebody was skipping by singing while I'm struggling. But anyway, I also put this judgment, this guy's a player. You know, he's a player. And then, not only is he a player, but he scooped up my priest, and he took him to all the bars. We would go one way, and they would go the bar way. And so we get to Santiago, and actually they were there, and they were ahead of us, so I thought. And I started crying and blah, 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 blah. And I thought, oh, the priest, but the priest didn't have enough time for me. He was in a hurry. He had something he needed to do. But my player dude from Dublin came up, gave me a hug, and he said, you know what, you were such a gift to me on this trail. And it was just like, oh, my God. Thank you. One more click off on who you can judge, right?
The other lesson learned, you have your two or three changes of clothes in your backpack, your toiletries, and your foul weather gear. Really pretty liberating.
Awesome.
In fact, right now we are downsizing our house. When we got home, we went through our closets and...
We're actually selling our
house. Finding balance in your life. I mean, for me, it was a big thing. I was always the work. And now...
We're going back to Spain because he's kind of forgetting that one.
And we're going to walk across Ireland or walk across it. We're going crazy. Finding your passion. I mean, we all have a passion, and yeah, I think there was a comedian, it was Red Skelton, used to say, ain't none of us getting out of this alive. And it's very true. And we got to find that balance to...
And talking to people is Gregg's, one of Gregg's passions, and it's fun. It's
also brought back the wonder. You know, to me, sometimes you're all out walking 3 to 5 hours or 8 hours a day, you start noticing the shape of the clouds and the flowers. And those are things we notice when we were little kids. When we become adults, we kind of goes away. The other day, quickly, I was out in front of a grocery store, and there was a thunderstorm up there, and I was looking at it, and I was like, wow. And I caught myself, and the ladies were putting the kids in the car, and they're going, who is this guy?
Locking the doors really quick.
Who's the guy zoning on the car?
That's right. What's anybody doing standing
there? So living in the now is a huge lesson. Yeah, we've only got now.
The biggest thing about that there is you, most of the time, not all the time, but most of the time, you have got to watch where you put every foot. You know, you have to watch every foot. How can you be someplace else but right here? You have to be right here. So for 500 miles, for 38 days, you get to be right here. It's really a blessing.
And it's taking care of yourself mentally and physically. This is the only one we get. We live in a huge, beautiful planet. We're very blessed to live here. The history when you're over there, you're walking on 2,000-year-old Roman roads. I mean, I could feel the ghost from who has walked on this road. You know, whether it been the slaves, the artisans, the Charlemagne or Caesar, is just, you can feel all that. And again, our lessons learned, bring it back around, is overcoming fear.
Yep, they usually never happen. Mm-hmm. Mine, obviously, is another one that's non-judgment. That played out a lot.
Living in now, family and friends, I mean, that's one of the most important things. People and connected, we're all connected. And maybe preaching to the choir in this audience here, but we really are. We're more alike than we are different. Spiritual is a big thing, the power of intention. And the thing that we got to the end, I kept hearing, anybody hear the song by R.E.M., It's the End of the World?
As we know it.
Was,
I feel fine.
That's all I kept hearing. Is, I came home and I was been watching
not
that
only,
YouTube.
Not only is that what he kept hearing, but that was what he kept singing.
I like the last line. And
I feel fine.
And life is now different. I mean, it was a huge... And in closing, for some, this is a journey for the athletic challenge. It was me at first. Others, it's an inward journey. And others, it's a hospital for the soul. We met people that had lost their family, or one guy, his wife had died in the Netherlands, and he'd walked out of the door, and he was walking to Portugal. And it's just, it was something. What's next? Another Camino walk? Maybe Israel, maybe Scotland. We want to walk on all continents. Morgan has a book called You Are the Christ. It's about
are
the
you? You. You Are the Christ is a coming sequel that we think, I guess.
Are you
the Christ is the one here?
Also, we had, I think, if you want to be on our newsletter or want to...
I saw you get, this got handed out.
And, you know, let us know about our talk. We may lead a group next year if you're interested in that. If you want to follow us, and we've got a handout. We've got a website, it's incredibleoutthere.com. We're on Facebook, it's incredible out there, but... please stay in touch, and thank you very much.
Thanks for having us.